Well, good morning, Lionhearts. I just made breakfast, and when I went to record my very first clip of the day, the camera was all jittery again, and I go, what the hell? So I look in the settings, everything got reset again last night. After I just turned the autofocus and the video stabilization on, it was all shut off again. So I went to turn on the autofocus. Now, their options only give you either autofocus or video stabilization. You can't use them both. But I'm going to go ahead and eat, and then I'm going to take Ja over to Pollyanna's house, and he's going to play today. And I have a whole list of things I'm going to do. Hey, Joster. Can I ask you a question? You're going to Pollyanna's today, aren't you? Yeah. Days with Jordan the Lion begins now. And a big thank you to this guy. In the light of all the drama that's been going on my channel the last 2 days, that I believe is now over, he took the time to comment on a couple of my videos yesterday. Kind of makes me think I might have a new subscriber, but he sent a little comment that said, keep the faith, you're doing good work. That means a lot. That's like the Lou Gehrig to Babe Ruth. Because my two favorite YouTubers are Adam and Casey Neistat, and that's for one of those guys to go out of their way just to comment and say, you're doing good work. That meant a lot, especially somebody who's had to endure way more nonsense than I ever have. And, yeah, I think we got a new friendship going. He even said he loved the Mauritania part of the vlog the other day. He loves old Hollywood, so pretty cool. Thanks, Adam. I appreciate that. There's the little speedball. Getting ready to take him over to Pollyanna's. Alright, let's go do some vlogging. I was watching Sayonara last night, and that kind of determined what I was gonna go vlog today. If you haven't seen the Marlon Brando Red Buttons classic, directed by Josh Logan, go watch it. And oh god, I don't want to forget, Jim Rockford's in it too. We're going to a restaurant that doesn't open till 5 o'clock, and it's only noon now, so I thought this might be the best time to go. Yamashiro. Alright, we're here. See if I can find what I'm looking for. Came out to vlog and the tour buses already beat me to it. Okay, let's go take a look. Let me go show you where a very memorable scene from the movie was filmed, right up here. Now here's the front, and this is basically what happened was, in the movie, Lloyd, played by Marlon Brando, this building, the Yamashiro restaurant, actually acts as the American Officers Club in Sayonara. And so, when you actually see this, is the scene where Marlon Brando is dating a colonel's daughter. And the colonel has him transferred from where he was already stationed to Tokyo, and there's really nothing for him to do here. He does it just so he can hang out with his fiance daughter. And they pull up right here, and this is the scene where they hop out, and Marlon Brando observes that James Garner is trying to bring in his date, who is Japanese, into the American Officers Club.
That's beautiful, isn't it?
Are there any rules against it?
Well, no, there are no rules against it, but it's understood.
I thought the club would be honored.
And they don't want to let her in. And so they end up basically having to tell him that he's not welcome to bring her here, and they leave. And you can see the kind of the overlooking of the city, which is weird because they did a pretty good job of just putting just enough props in the way, kind of in this background, that would make it look like it was somewhere else. Like you can actually see this in the background, and they have a pool and everything down there. Different gardens and fountains. Now this was really the only thing that was filmed here was the American Officers Club, because none of the garden scenes where Marlon Brando falls in love with the geisha woman, none of that happened here, but.
I understand how you feel, Captain, and I'm very embarrassed, but
I'm sorry.
Like I said, this was pretty cool because that whole scene happens right here. Their car pulls up right here. You see the altercation where James Garner is asking for special permission to bring his girlfriend and they say like no. And even Marlon Brando goes over and says, why did you try and bring her in here? You knew that it's... He said, well, I just, you know, I thought it was an American club. I thought I could probably get away with it.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Don't you know that there's such thing as insolence through manner?
Thank you, sir.
It really highlights how much racism there was towards the Japanese culture and the Japanese people because of, the war and everything. And the movie takes place in the 50s, so it's after World War II, and it looks like they have a lock on this, so I'll just walk around a little bit of the grounds. But the movie basically shows a kind of small town farm boy who Marlon Brando portrays in this movie, and it just kind of shows him going from having the mentality of his whole life is based around falling into line with what is expected of him, which is he's in the military, he's expected to rise the ranks, get married to a woman who understands the life of a military man, and he's pretty racist. He even makes the comment of like a slant-eyed runt when he's talking about Red Button's girlfriend fiance, and that's when Red Button says, hey, I'm not gonna let you talk about her like that or anybody else talk to her like that. I don't care what your rank is. And you kind of see a little bit of a look come over Marlon Brando's face, which is the great part about his acting, is that you start to see the realization of maybe I'm wrong. And then as soon as James Garner takes him over to see the woman he will soon fall in love with, as soon as he sees her, he thinks she's the most spectacular thing he's ever seen in his life. And we then see Marlon Brando completely become a different character in the movie. But it all starts right here. The narrow-mindedness that he begins with here and meeting James Garner right over here. Pretty cool. I'm just showing you guys a little bit more of the grounds. I've never been up here to eat or anything, I can't attest to if the restaurant's any good, but it's pretty famous, pretty well known. Now, they do actually revisit this place later on in the movie. And that's also, it's funny how like, they always will use like these kind of places for like two scenes in the movie whenever I go visit them, and they're always like key scenes. So the second key scene is they're throwing the party at the officers club here and Marlon Brando doesn't show up. And that's when his fiance, who's already kind of got to the realization that maybe her relationship is ending, she says, well, I know for sure he knew about it because I sent three different messages or like telegrams inviting him. And when they track him down, he's over at basically what they would view as cavorting with the Japanese. But you can't stop a man in love, especially not Marlon Brando. So anyway, let me go over to the other side of the building because they basically show the front of the building again for that secondary shot when they come back here. But there's a scene that's a conversation between Marlon Brando's like fiance's dad, who is his superior, and another man, and it takes place right inside this doorway, actually, literally right inside there.
Well, come on in, boys. Eileen has to change.
Now, I don't know what it looks like on the inside, but you don't really go that much inside the place in the movie, other than there's a bar right there. You can see the umbrellas, kind of. And in the movie, you see Marlon Brando and his date getting a drink there. And other than that, you don't see much else from here. It was pretty amazing to me when I walked up here to see how small this area really is where they filmed it, because really puts into perspective what wide-angle lenses do. It's super cramped up here, but to know that there was a car there, and then where I'm pretty much standing, you would have seen another car parked. It's pretty cramped. All right, I just wanted to come look around. I have my eye on, like I told you guys, two different cameras. I just want to see what they look, what the picture looks like here. Can't see that online. I walked in and I walked around for about 5 minutes and nobody would help me. So I went up to an information desk and they said, Oh, can I help you? You look lost. And I said, yeah, I'm just kind of hoping that somebody was going to help me. Do you guys sell cameras here? I don't see any cameras. And she goes, oh, you got to go to the third floor for that. So let's go to the third floor. I think that might be the guy. They also don't have footage of any of the video. If I would have brought a video card, they said I could have put the video card in and tried it out. But I don't know. I might go home and maybe grab my video card and come back and try it out. He said at least till tomorrow, if you buy it here, you get a year warranty and it covers the tax. So that saves me like almost $80. Check out their classic camera collection here. Old lenses and everything. Alright gang, I gotta hit the post office again. I sold something else and I just went to the store to buy some mailers, so I'm all good on that. You didn't have to see that. But I have a vlog that I've wanted to do for a little while, and I was able to find, it's a really hard location to find, I was able to find two videos of it. One of the videos had trespassing in it, and I don't want to go down that road. The other video, the people were able to find someone who let them onto the property. So what I'm doing is I tracked down one of the people that made the video, and I'm going to meet with him, and I'm going to try and talk to him and see if he will consider hooking me up with the person that let him on the property. And I don't know. We'll see what happens. This is for a future vlog. Sometimes, I don't know if you guys know this, I mean, like, some of these vlogs, they take some time to be able to do. I really put in a lot of work sometimes. Days, weeks before I ever do the vlog, trying to set up things. And it's weird, sometimes I think like, man, I can't believe how long it took me to arrange or organize, like, to meet with somebody, to interview them or whatever, and then it's all for one day. You know, it's like I post it and then the next day I have to come up with something else or do something else, and, you know, sometimes those videos are the ones that are the lowest viewed too, so it's always weird. But I'm gonna throw my hat in the ring and see if I can appeal to this guy's sense of historical value and see if maybe since he made his video like 2 years ago, if he'd be willing to help me out make mine. Well, no luck, he wasn't here yet. The business where I was gonna come and talk to him is actually closed right now, so I'll have to come back another time. All right, let's knock this out. All right, the return. Let's see what happens this time. You know I'm loving this hallway right now. 1986. The gig that got him signed. Their big hangout after all their concerts back in that day was like not too far from here. It was called Cantor's. It is happening. It is happening. And I got that with my camera. It's amazing how much bigger a salesman smiles once he's made a sale. They go from looking pretty bored and half asleep to all smiles. Also, I have 15 days to return it if there's something wrong or if I don't like it. So I figured that was the safest bet. Save myself $80 for buying it now. Like I told you guys, the camera just came out like 2 weeks ago, so they're not gonna lower the price anytime soon. I figured this was the best time to get it. Well, I'm gonna go pick up Jaw now so I get to see him for a little bit tonight, but I just found out I'm gonna work tomorrow all the way in Palmdale. So he's gonna go back over tonight or tomorrow morning and hang out with Pollyanna again. Picking up Jaw. So the reason that I decided I was gonna get the camera now, in case anybody was wondering, is I always had intentions of bumping up to a DSLR or something like that at some point. Here's the thing, I feel like this is just my mentality on how life works. I feel like your life is broken down into three different lives. The life that you have from the time that you're born until you're 18, when you really have no say,
as to what you do, because you have parents, you're not a legal adult. Then you have a life from the time that you're like 18 to like the time that I would say what you retire, when you have obligations where you have to make a living. And then you have like a life from like the time you retire till the time you die. From the time that I turned 18 and I moved out here when I was 18, started my second life, all on my own. Michael was the first friend that I had. We were in music school together. We stayed in the same hostel, and he was looking at buying an amplifier and I was looking at selling an amplifier. He came over to try it out, saw some stuff in my apartment. He's like, "Do you write songs?" And I was like, "Yeah." He goes, "Play me something. I want to record somebody at some point." So I played him my song and he goes, "I will record you anytime you want." And since 2000, no matter what's been going on in Michael's life, if he was doing university, where he had night classes, that guy has been there for me all the time. There have been times that I get to see Michael maybe two times a year because his work schedule was so intense that that's all he had time for. The guy worked 7 days a week sometimes. Michael is also, you know, when my car would break down, no matter where I was, no matter what time, he will answer the phone and he will come help. Michael is not the kind of person that gifts mean anything to. He appreciates things, but he doesn't need anything. In his life, everything is all about practicality. So there's no wedding present that I can get him that will really do anything, and his fiance is the same way. However, when I was in a really rough patch at one point, I thought about leaving California, and the only person I really felt that I owed an explanation to was Michael, and I just sent him an email. I think we were texting, and he just said, "How's everything going?" I was like, "It's pretty bad, man. I'm actually considering leaving now." And he wrote me back and said, "You know what? I would support you going on a vacation and getting away for a while, but I don't support you never coming back." He's like, "Out of everybody that we've ever known out here, you have the most ability at doing something that involves being here. And I will put my money where my mouth is." He's like, "I will, if you need money, if you need help, I'm going to invest in you. I will invest in you because I know that you're worth it." And he goes, "And if you want to pay me back, you can. And if you don't, if you want to, you know, I have a lot of projects around the house that I need to get done. If you want to come out and help me with those, then we can just trade it off like that." And I was like, nobody offers to do that for a friend. Nobody. In fact, isn't that like the number one key to friendship is don't ask for money, don't lend money? I didn't ask. He just felt compelled to offer it. And so the very next weekend, I went out to help him. And while we were working, I said, how could you afford to do that? And he goes, "Well, I got laid off." And I go, "What?" I go, "Dude, you cannot loan me money if you just got laid off." He goes, "It's a funny story, Jordan." He goes, "I got laid off. I put my resume up on one of those like job sites or whatever. A recruiter called me, sent me out on something." He goes, "Long story short, I have been doing like freelance stuff for like the last 2 months." He goes, "I made like half my salary in 2 months." He goes, "I'm in a position to help you and I want to." So for me, it's like, you can't buy the guy anything. Nothing that you purchase him will mean anything. And he's always made sure that I was a part of his life no matter what was going on. We've been best friends. And for me, now that I am vlogging and now that I've kind of got my own style, to me it was like, out of 17 years we've been talking about me going and visiting his homeland, seeing where he grew up, hanging out with his family. Like, I've already met a bunch of his friends that have flown here. And for me, it was just like, the best thing that I can possibly do is create a movie out of this 2 weeks for Michael's life. Give it to him, and like, whenever they want to watch it and be sentimental, they can. And that's the best thing I can do. So I probably wouldn't have bought the camera if his wedding wasn't coming up. But seeing as how it is coming up, seeing as how there is a deal on it right now, and seeing as how I really want to know how to work it, I will always have my cell phone in my pocket for my point and shoot, and we'll just see what happens. Where's my buddy? Where's my buddy? There he is. Aren't you jealous that you're not paying $2.91 for gas like I am? I have to. Apparently where I'm working tomorrow is like over an hour away. First time I've ever seen that bumper sticker. Cool to be Catholic. So I wanted to say, yesterday my mom had a surgery on her shoulder, and
They did numerous things. She's been in a lot of pain, and hopefully this takes care of everything. I actually filmed a little snippet about it yesterday, wanting everybody to like wish her a get well. And then when I went to put it in, because of the update or whatever that my camera phone had done, it cut off half the message. So I ended up taking it out when I was editing the final one, and I wanted to put it in there now. She does a lot for me. She's a big fan of the channel. She always offers suggestions, and I hope her recovery is a quick, speedy one, and I hope that whatever soap opera she's watching while she's recovering is as good as she wants it to be, so that she doesn't have to sit there in misery.